Hey subscribers, how's it going? I haven't made an upload in a while and I'm kind of neglecting the YouTube channel for a little bit, so I feel like I do need to give you guys a little bit of build progress. So basically I'm just going to kind of go through and just kind of upload the daily progress of the day and give you an idea of how the day-to-day progress goes. You know, I mean, it's slow but tedious. You know, it's like everybody knows the tortoise and the hare story. You know, the turtle wins. All right, so today we're gonna do a bunch of dry fitment, get all these parts onto the car and basically have an idea of what needs to be repaired and what's just gonna get cut off and basically tossed off to the side. We're gonna have to need to know where the mating portions are gonna be and make sure that all the taillights and all the pockets are gonna fit, make sure the door has nice even gaps. But for now, we're gonna start with the front end and we're gonna move our way back from there. Doing that, it's just more solid progress, and once you get the whole front end, you know, put together, it's a lot easier to utilize the progress because it actually looks like you got more done than you actually did. So with that said, we do have the RS front bumper. We're not gonna use the 22B front bumper just because sheer fact that this is actually a little bit more aggressive and I can actually flex it out to go with the wider fenders. So it's actually already been done. So with that said, we're going to unbox the Greddy lip today also as well. And that's actually going to make this bumper look a lot more aggressive. So that's basically where we're going. We're trying to make the 22B not look so bubbly and make it look mean, because as everybody knows, or as I should say, for you new viewers, we're gonna do an EG33 swap in this car. And then after I get it in there, it's all mechanically sound, I know that it's running tip top, I'm gonna build a twin turbo kit for it. Now, we're gonna rotate the intake manifold on top, gonna do the 180 conversion, do the TIG welding around. We're gonna have to cut it in half to do the flip, because you can't just symmetrically flip it around like the EJ motors are. So with that said, that's obviously more fabrication down the road that needs to be done. So I don't wanna get in too much detail with that. That's something that is gonna be more towards the engine build portion of this. So today, we just want to get everything fitted so we know that everything fits correctly, and it just really takes out a lot of stress and work that we can just check off that list over there. So with that said, that's what we're going to do today, is get a bunch of dry fitment done and make this thing look pretty again, because that rust is ugly. Cut faster, faster, faster. I want to see what it looks like. Damn, I'm using that dull ass junk knife. What the hell, man? Why is that even in the shop still? Let's go throw it in a tree somewhere.
You're the fucking over here.
Listen, don't be telling people I know how to throw knives.
I don't want to cut myself like you do.
Come on, man, you got that box open yet?
You got your mouth closed yet?
What the hell? My mouth's about to be on the floor, I'm sure, as soon as I see it. Ooh, my life be like, ooh, shiny.
Damn.
I know, that's pretty snazzy, right? That is nice.
There you go.
Yep. You got it upside down there, bud.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You had it right. Mm-hmm. That tab, that flap is actually going to go, that goes right in the bell mouth portion.
Oh, man, hold on.
Yeah, well, go ahead, man. Slide her on there. Put her skirt on. It's a big difference. It's going to take a little bit of manipulation. No, 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 no. You got to put the flap inside the bell mouth.
Yeah,
yeah, man.
Damn.
Everything goes right up in there like a pocket.
Okay.
Yes, sir. He's never done it before, guys. So he's learning.
Okay, I see
it. You got to learn somewhere, man. Or sometime.
It's going to have to.
Yeah, it's going to take a little bit of manipulation.
That's going to look really good.
Yeah, it's going to look great. You know, so we'll go ahead and see if we can get that in there. I'll give him a hand.
I say it should be pretty easy. It's real. Oh, man. Yeah.
Holy shit!
Big difference, right?
Turn this right out of the way.
Not bad. Real simple installation, which is good because how easy that went on. I'll be able to paint this bumper, and with just a little bit of tape wrapped around it, we don't have to worry about it scratching, you know, so we'll be able to slide it on.
And it doesn't look like there's a lot of pressure or anything in there.
No, that's slipped right on.
I tell you what,
that's really nice form fitment if you're looking for a really nice tight lip. Look how well that form fits around this edge here. You know, that's really nice. There's no gaps. So, and, you know, most lips I've received in the mail were always, like, you know, wavy and whatnot. So this is actually really nice stuff. And it's made of the exact same material as the OEM bumper. It is polyurethane. So it's going to flex if he hits anything. So that's great.
Found this envelope in the box also as well before he tore it down. So hopefully I got some stickers. If I could do this one-handed. What's that? What's that? Metal? What's it say? Oh, ooh. Shit, it's a metal Greddy tag. Well, it's actually really nice, actually. Okay. It's metal. Comes with a 3M, so I'm taking that's going on the lip after I paint it. So everybody knows that it's authentic. Oh, yay! Japanese paper that I don't understand. Oh, these are installation directions. Gotta love it. Yeah. Hey. Look at that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Nothing else in there. And Greddy we trust. Yeah, you look silly with no fenders.
Well, that's a big difference, though. Quite the aggression, how it already racks it out. Now imagine having these fenders on there. It should look pretty snazzy. Hey, put them fenders on there.
You're going to drop the bumper.
Your face is going
to
drop the bumper.
All right, we'll see. Should just set right on there. Now, pull that bumper here, the edge of the bumper, out to the, yeah, and then form fit it to the edge of that fender. You can do it, I believe in you. Pull the edge out where you see where your right hand is. Yeah, now pull it out. Yeah, now, there you go. Oh, look at that.
Let me get some tissues over here.
Oh, dude, hold on. I'll get the Vaseline. I'll be right back. I'm going to go get it.
Hey.
Bloopers!
Fuck it.
Alright, so...
Fucking Frogger over here. Helping across the road!
So, what do you think? Looks pretty good, right? Well, I think it'd look a lot better if that wasn't a fog light and that wasn't a fog light, because I'm not a big fog light guy. We ended up going with some fog light covers, the ones with the mesh in the center, so that, you know, it gets a lot more air into the engine bay. But really, that's not what I'm looking for as far as throwing air in there. I'm trying to just, well, let me just show you. So I want to take two of these VF39s. Everybody knows the STI turbo. They usually came on the Hawkeyes, you know, 06, 07s, stock turbo. They run up to anywhere between 18 and 20 PSI, depending on the, depending on the engine, on the actuator. But this is what I'm thinking. I'm thinking one right here and one right here. Two individual intercoolers, run some piping, H6 in there. So basically, instead of one of these, which would normally be feeding a four-cylinder engine, will now only be feeding three cylinders. So I'm going to take a lot less tolerance off of it. I'm going to have a faster spool rate. And yeah, I think it's going to be badass. So with that said, it's never been done, so that's really what I like to achieve, or things that have never been done. Obviously, this has been done, so we're gonna go a little over and beyond with it and see if we can make it a little bit more aggro. I'm more about the aggressive look and aspect of overbuilding things, so it's go big or go home.
All right, so we got the kit pretty much dry fit on as best as possible. I'm trying to utilize the gaps that I want. Now, this is just sitting here, as you can see, with tape. I'm going to have to actually put the door hinge in for the locking mechanism sitting on the striker, and then actually put the two hinges on. Before I actually put these hinges in, I noticed that when I held this up to the actual light, spectrum coming through this door here, it was shining through the door and I could see a lot of thin portions on this skin itself. And it also exposed actually a couple pinholes. There's a pinhole here, there's one here, and then there's actually one in this area here. So I'm gonna have to get on the inside of the door and do a little bit more resin matting, because this area shines a lot of light. So does this area here. And then there's a few areas also around that are super thin on this skin. Now, I'm highly impressed with the finish and the fitment of this kit. So I'm not trying to knock it at all. I'm only trying to point out the flaws that are with it, because I'm very, what's the word for it? Honest. That's the word I'm looking for. I'm just going to be as honest as possible. Real sees real, and I'm just going to be real. I'm not trying to inflate this kit and make it to where everybody goes out and buys it, but I mean, obviously I'd love to see more 22Bs out there. That'd be amazing, but these are expensive, and for the amount of money that's shilled out on them, I kind of feel like maybe they probably should have put some light on the end of the, inside of this door, and possibly check the actual mill thickness of the door skin itself, because I can see in a lot of areas that there's a lot of discrepancies where they may have laid fiberglass more in certain areas than others. It almost looks kind of patchy, especially when the light is shining through the inside of the door. So I might actually have to shut some lights off in here, put a flashlight in here, and actually show you what I'm talking about. All right, so I got Tyler in there right now. We actually just checked it real quick during the day to see if we're even gonna have to shut off lights, and we don't even have to shut off the lights to actually show you what I'm talking about. So there's Tyler, he's got the flashlight, and you get an idea of what I mean by extremely clear. Now you can see in a lot of portions, this is a huge discrepancy, and then that's a pinhole, probably hard to see with the, it's, It's a little difficult to see, but you can see how thin these panels are, you know. But this, there's a pinhole here, there's one here, and then there's definitely one here. So, well, actually, you can kind of see it, you know, right there in the camera. But that's something that I can actually see through the door itself. You know, so that's why the saying goes, guys, if it ain't right, you paint it white. The shit fucking hides, you know. So it's nothing much you can do about it until you actually get into it and pick it apart. You know, like I do. I'm kind of famous for it. That's really my thing, is to pick your shit apart and make you step your game up. Because I'm kind of sick of everybody's lack of quality, get it in, get it out, make that money, and kind of fuck you over type deal. And that's not me. That's not what I'm about. I really do try to achieve the best quality level that can be achieved. You know, even if I have to surpass myself, I will absolutely do that. All right, so with that said, before I can actually mount this on here, I've got an idea for my body lines. I know that these are going to sit relatively in this space and in this pocket before I can actually figure out what needs to be trimmed, because you can see the overhang. This panel actually overhangs onto the door, which is why you can't see the gap or the actual line. Now, behind this tape, I've actually already done the fender line. It's hard to see. Hold on, let me turn the light on. All right, so with the light on, see if you can focus. See, I've already got the fender gap, or the actual panel gap that I'm looking for. You know, there's my finger in there, so it's a couple eighths of an inch, and that's really the ideal gap. It does match the gap here, so that's really what I'm trying to do, is equalize this gap. Now, this fitting on here, when I did first initially put it on, I didn't have the overlap. I had it actually butted off, and so this actually hangs off. Now, they do give you kind of a pocketed portion here, but it doesn't fit exactly on here. So I think the best way for this to be actually mounted onto the car itself is to actually trim it and then socket it on by removing the metal portion behind and then manipulating the actual backer here for this taillight to fit into this fiberglass pocket. Now, I really want to remove as much of this steel as possible, because this is what happens to steel if it's not protected and done correctly. And this is just years and years and years of neglect. You know, this is not the owner's fault now. So that is what it is. You know, that's how you have to look at it. So with these, the arcs are different, you know, so I wanted to see with a dry fitment that what needs to stay and what's going bye-bye, and that is the lines that you're looking at. Now, you want to make sure that you have, you know, basically to do this and to fit this quarter panel in the right position to know exactly where it needs to be, is you look at the gap between the tire and the portion of the panel. Now, you know that this is all completely even as it runs all the way around, and we know that they have a nice even gap. So with that proportion, we know that this panel is in the right position. So I'll remove this door. I'll take a marker and I'll score it from the back side, a paint marker, and paint that whole back side of this quarter panel using the edge of the quarter panel, the existing quarter panel. And then I'll remove this panel, and then all I have to do is just trim it on that line to where you don't see any paint anymore, and then I'll put this back on and it will match perfectly with the line that I scored it with. And then I'll know that this is exactly where it needs to be, and then I can start mounting it and getting it stationary. But first, after all that drawn out talk, I need to come back up to the front and we need to start doing some pilot holes so that we can get everything form fitted properly. Now, there's no hood, so we got to put a hood on there and see if we can get the fender gaps perfect, just like the doors are. That way we know that we have a little bit of room and given space to fit it perfectly. You know, obviously there's no perfect in this world, but we're going to try to achieve it as best as possible.
Thank you.
See, I kind of thought so. Like the.
Is that not in all the way?
So this is actually going to come out. See, like this is.
From this side of the code?
Yeah. It looks like this area has been pushed. So okay. This portion here on the radiator support
right,
it's actually got to get pulled.
Okay.
So we can get this.
Oh, I see it now. Yeah, I see it.
Yeah, you see it now?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So like this line, this is perfect. You see how the headlights are all, mm-hmm. they're matching up. And then this is right on the bumper line itself. You see the grill, how it follows this portion. See how the bumper swoops up to the grill itself.
Right
so,
here.
Yeah. So you want, that's what your body line is. That's what you're trying to go off of. Push it right to the headlight and you look on the actual metal bumper itself, see how it fits right in that plug hole perfectly. So you know you're right where you're supposed to be.
Yeah, you can even see it just coming
absolutely. Right. The factory alone is going to give you the guidelines to look for. You just need to dry fit so you can actually see. Because if you don't do this and then you paint this and you go to put this on,
it's fucked.
It's fucked. Exactly. So you want everything to be right, and as you can see, you know, I can almost put my finger behind here, and then this is nice and perfect, you know? And even this, that's where that's supposed to sit, because I got a broken clip right here.
Right.
So once I replace that clip, that'll sit perfect. Look how nice that sits. That's nice, right? Mm-hmm. So we know here that steel for this headlight itself is actually bolted to behind this grill. Yeah. That's got to get pulled forward by this much space. So, yeah, so now you measure how much here it needs to come forward, and then when we disassemble this, then we take a tape measure and we pull it forward that much, yeah. And then we know that when we go to dry fit it, it's in the realm to where I could probably manipulate it with my hands.
Right.
So that's basically...
You do that, you're trying to...
All right, so got the grill off, and as I thought, you can kind of see where the dimple is, you know, the dent. So that portion here on the top is actually pushed back a little bit, and it's causing the top portion of the headlight not to have proper fitment. You know, over here, you can see that this is nice and flat and exactly right where it's supposed to be, and that is not. It's pushed right in. So we're going to go ahead and remove this headlight and hammer and dolly that back up to where it's got to be. So then we can do a little bit more dry fitment and get that proper OEM look. All right, so I got all the body lines all right, and in order to tell is you actually go off of the actual bumper itself and everything is all even, runs nicely all across the actual line, the OEM lines, and that's really what you're looking for is that fitment. Now you also want to make sure that the headlights themselves are also pivoted and arced in the same gaps all the way across the bottom, alongside of the grill, and then come over here and make sure that they are also symmetrical as the other side as well. So you stand back and you get an idea of the true symmetry of what it could look like. Now you want it all also to match up where the grill portion is, so that everything looks nice and even. You can see the nice even gap across the hood. Now this hood is just literally sitting down and it's not latched, you know, it's just sitting stationary. So that's the best way to get your gaps is in a stationary position. And then you can throw your rubber adjusters in on top of the radiator support and you can adjust your hood after that. But if it fits perfectly just sitting stationary, you know that you have very little to none for adjustment wise. Damn, dude. Just sucks up that 18 by 10 like nothing. Wow. Makes that 18 look so small. I love it.
Your wheel is puny.
Your wheel is so tiny. Wow. 18 by 10. Offset plus 22. Yeah. Look at that lip. Look how big that is. Finger width. And you got 3.5 inches. Damn! That looks so good on there. Too bad these wheels aren't designated for this car. Wow. So nice. But dang, gives you an idea of what it's going to look like with some wheels on this thing. Wow. That fitment. Look at that. Actually, the wheel will actually be out just a little bit more, but you'll get an idea. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and end it right there. We basically got a decent amount done with that car. It's all basically fitted exactly, or I should say fit exactly where it's supposed to be. You know, we got that dry fitment, so we know that the fender gaps and basically all the gaps that run around are exactly where I want them to be so that we're not fighting this. Now, everything you see is just sitting there. There is no hardware, there's nothing. So literally it's nice. There's no tension, there's no strain, there's nothing on this car right now. So I know all I gotta do is just run a couple pilot holes where all the bungs go for all of the OEM hardware and just put it through the hole. It's really that simple at this point in time. So that's the reason why I take the time to manipulate everything and actually look at it, excuse me, and check all the gaps. You know, you really have to go through it and pay attention to these things, because once you get to that paint time, there's really no going back on manipulating something that has fresh paint on it. You know, you chip that, you scratch that, or even worse, you drop that, good chance you're getting fired. So, and a guy like me, well, when you own the place, you kind of just kick yourself in the nuts and just deal with it, but you don't want to be that guy. So do it right, you know, so go through it, take the time. Put that love into it, because everybody knows what makes a Subaru is love. And we go that extra mile for a reason. We love these things. So be that guy. You know, don't hack these things up. Don't be the guy that's posting shit on Instagram, Facebook, saying, hey, look at my shit, and it looks like shit. So really, in all reality, take the time, take the effort to make it look right. Because, you know, clean is mean, and that's the way it's always going to be. So get that clean look, make sure the fitment's right, and you really don't have to fight with it. So with that said, now it's time to focus on the GD body. I'm going to move over to that and just kind of acclimate to getting into my welding portion. You know, I've got to finish up the patch repair that's over here now. Got that all cut out, basically all ready to go as far as the outside portion is all cleaned up. Now the inside lip that my patch that I made is going to have to weld to this. Well, it's rotted. It's no longer there anymore, so I'm going to have to make that. But before I do that, I'm going to have to actually clean it up and find out where is clean metal, and because I gotta cut that out. I can't leave that in there. You know, a lot of people will grind that out and, you know, and spray some epoxy primer over it and whatnot. And that's really not where I'm looking to go with this. I'm trying to do it right. I don't want it to come back and have any issues with it. Yeah, I'm gonna seal it up. But if it has any cancer or any kind of rust in there, it's a chemical reaction. It's something that's not gonna stop. It's just gonna keep going and going and going. No matter, even if you left a tiny little salt grain, just a little tiny little grain of it, that will spread and it will eventually be a hole. You know, there's nothing much you can do about that. So with that said, I'm gonna move over to this and basically focus on welding for the rest of the day. So yeah, tune in for the next upload for jumping on this. And I'll show you a little bit of portion real quick of, where's that patch panel at? What do I do with that thing that I made for this? Oh, it's over here. Okay, so I don't like cutting and manipulating metal is really my thing. So I went ahead and I made the patch panel. Now it's got a backer on it so that I can slip it in like a puzzle piece. And I have that backer of steel to weld into. So that's your best way of doing it. And it's also iCar certified. Now, I know you iCar technicians out there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You know, you can't just butt weld these panels up to each other and get in an accident. And there's a really good chance that your weld is going to break because you're just going to grind that weld down nice and flat. And that leaves the mill thickness of that weld pretty weak. So welds are pretty strong when you leave the weld there, but when you grind it down and the actual mill thickness, and maybe you just didn't get penetration, you know, shit happens. So I went ahead and I made this in a solid piece. As you can see, you know, I form fitted it, you know, so it's even got the rails. It's even got the inside, you know, lip as OEM, you know, like it's supposed to have, you know, and I just started out with a piece of flat steel. So if you're looking to find out how I make these, you know, and I'll show you, I mean, it's extremely tight fitment, you know, everything's going to piece right up in here, and then you'll have the backer itself, which goes up in, let's see if I can do this one-handed, and then this pocket, this ledge here, the backer itself, will then tuck in behind this, and it'll all be a puzzle piece, and this backer will sit behind here. Well, before I put this in here, I'm gonna have to punch some holes in here so that I can do the same thing. I can weld through this into the backer and it holds my panel in place in the exact placement that I want it to be. And then after that, I'm able to accommodate down here to the bottom rust and get that all done because I've gotta get this portion repaired. But before I can do that, there's some seam sealer in here from the factory. It's got to get chipped out because that stuff is highly flammable. You don't want to weld on that and then burn the whole car down because you didn't scrape out something that took literally 2 seconds to do. So take the time, open your eyes, and pay attention to it, you know? So again, don't be that guy. All right, so I'm Bill Schneider. This is Rumble Garage. I work on only cars with the stars. Subaru only. Thanks, guys. Hope you subscribe. Hit that like button. Drop me a comment. Let me know how I'm doing. Have a great one.